will not leave the 19-year-old stateless in line with international law. So what should happen to foreign fighters after the fall of IS? Well, joining me now to talk about it in more detail, Dr. Alan Mendoza, the executive director of the Henry Jackson Society, who doesn't think she should be allowed back to the UK. And from Essex, it's David Toube, who's director of policy at the Quilliam Foundation, who thinks Shamima Begum should be allowed back. Hello to you both. Thank you very much indeed for joining us on the programme this afternoon. Mr. Toube, to you first of all, if I may, why do you think she should be allowed back?
Well, I have to say, I am amazed to find myself in agreement with Jeremy Corbyn. I don't think I've ever been in agreement with him on any subject at all, but I have to say he is right on this. Shamima Begum and the other fighters from UK who went to Syria are made in Britain, and it is our mess, and I think we are under an obligation to clean it up. And what I mean by that is that these are people who are entirely radicalised while in the United Kingdom. Some of them had connections with Al-Mahajaroon, but for years and years, in the part of London in which Shamima Begum grew up, mainstream religious and political institutions peddled a single line, and that line was a caliphate must be created, Islam is under attack, you are under an obligation to support that caliphate, and the caliphate will purify society by applying the barbaric punishments we've seen in place. There were so many opportunities to stop her from going. They were missed, and we could have cleaned the problem up beforehand. We can't expect the rest of the world to be a dumping ground for Britain's problems.
It doesn't matter what she has done, Dr. Alan, she should be allowed to come back.
Well, look, I agree with the starting point of where David has come from. Clearly, she was radicalised in Britain, but then I divert, because she left this country voluntarily. She went and spent 4 years, as part of a terrorist state, terrorist organisation, fighting against this country. She's shown no remorse for that, as an adult today. And if we have a legal option to exclude someone from this country rather than have them back, where it is very uncertain that she could be prosecuted for whatever she's done over there, I think we're absolutely within our rights to take that option and exclude her from returning, because she is going to be a threat to public safety.
Mr. Toube, no regret, no remorse, not an ounce of sorry.
Again, I agree with all of that, but this is Britain's problem. We can't export that to other countries. We need to clean up our own mess. And, if Shamima Begum isn't in Britain, she will be in another country where she represents a threat to those people. And we have an obligation to those people as well. Now, there are things that we can do in the UK. We do not know that she cannot be prosecuted in the UK. We should make every effort to do so. We live in an era of social media, and teenagers in particular put every thought they have down on social media and personal media. And there is at least a prospect of prosecution her. If not, she can be subject to control orders, and those control orders can require her to stay in a particular place or to be subject to, and in particular, to be subject to de-radicalisation. Quilliam as an organisation has taken people who have been involved in terrorism or who have attempted terrorism. We have turned them from liabilities to this country into assets.
OK. Dr. Alan, we have a global social responsibility as the United Kingdom to neutralise the threat.
Well, we of course have a obligation to neutralise a threat, but let's look at what David's suggesting. He's saying we should, well, firstly, we need to get her back here. That could involve time, money, potentially putting people's lives at risk to bring her back, number one. Number two, as he himself says, it's unclear whether we could prosecute her. Perhaps we could, wonderful, but perhaps we couldn't, because as he knows, there are gaps in our sort of treason legislation and similar legislation, which haven't been filled, rather disgracefully, to be honest, since this problem has come up time and time again. And the worst possible outcome would surely be to put her in, to return her to the UK. She's not prosecuted, or is prosecuted in a way that fails to deliver what most people think she should be facing. De-radicalisation fails, because David will know that it's an uncertain process. Yes, there have been successes, but she clearly represents a very tough nut to crack, given the line she's already spouting right now. And then you have the prospect of releasing her onto the streets, even with, you know, consideration and cover, like he suggested, where she will undoubtedly be a poster girl for exactly the sorts of people he started this programme talking about, who will be looking to radicalise others, using her as an example. So the problem is that this could cascade down into the next generation.
David Toube, how would you propose, dealing with some of the questions that Dr Alan was posing there, how would you propose that she is brought back to the United Kingdom? I'm guessing that you don't think for one second that blood should be spilt in order to try to bring her back safely.
No, I think, to be honest, it is her responsibility to get to a place where she can come back to Britain. I don't think we have an obligation to expend resources on bringing her back. But the important point is that we don't expect the Syrian people to continue to pay the price for what we failed to put right in the first place. We're a rule of law country, we're a responsible country, and we can't expect other people to pay the price for our failings.
Yeah, but she does have, it would appear, nationality from four different countries, potentially.
It's very far from clear that that's the case. I have spent the better part of yesterday reading the SIAC judgments in the various appeals that have been made against attempts to deprive people of citizenship. What we would have in store if we tried to do that is probably something in the region of a 2-year expensive legal battle, which would be a waste of time. It would take constitute effectively kicking the can down the road and failing to address the problem at the point at which we should be, which is now.
So, Dr. Alan, we can't leave her stateless, and we can't necessarily prove, it may take a long, expensive legal battle to discover whether or not she does have nationality, potentially for three other countries, that being Holland, where her former husband came from, Syria, potentially, or Bangladesh.
Yes, it could be a long and drawn-out process, but let's remember why the Home Secretary has taken this decision. He deems her to be a security threat or a public safety threat. The point is, we do not want someone like her preaching what she is preaching to return to the UK where there is a chance that she could radicalise others. David is right, we have an obligation to everyone to stop this kind of radicalisation taking place, but we certainly have a first order of responsibility to our own people here in the UK to stop others being radicalised by someone we allow back, just because we move away from the legal option of depriving her of citizenship.
It's a legal option. But let me ask you this, Dr. Alan, if I may. She was 15 when she left. She was a child. She was a schoolgirl. There was radicalisation going on in her school. The authorities knew about it. They didn't tell her parents. The police knew about it. The school knew about it. No one told her parents, so they couldn't do anything about it. Do we not have to, on some level, accept responsibility for this young girl being radicalised, stealing her sister's passport and heading off to Syria?
I think there are obviously factors around that that we have to look at to ensure it doesn't happen. But let's be frank, who radicalised her? It wasn't the British state. It was people in this country or from abroad who did that radicalisation. They are responsible for this, not the British state. She did go as a child, that's quite correct, but she's now an adult. She's had time to think about what she has seen and what she has been through. And her answer is quite clear as an adult. I do not regret one moment of it. That's what she has said. She, as we know, thought the Manchester Arena bombing was, you know, justified as retribution. You can see where this is going in terms of her line of thinking as an adult.
Okay.
So, yes, she left as a child, but she's now an adult, and having her back as an adult with those views is clearly a public safety issue for this country.
OK, David Toube, she did say that she had no problem with what happened at the Manchester Arena. She did say that she found a severed head in a bin and it didn't faze her at all. A lot of work to do to try and get that girl back on track.
Yeah, she's done herself no favours, and she's clearly a very unattractive candidate for repatriation. But 2 points, really. First of all, there is a wealth of evidence that there are people who can start off as extremely dangerous extremists and become assets to this country. Majid Nawaz, when he was released from prison in Egypt, said pretty much the same thing on BBC Hardtop, that he didn't regret anything, that he hadn't changed his mind. And it took a couple of months before he had become one of the most outspoken advocates of liberty and democracy in this country. Noman Badnotman, who is the president of our organization, fought for a decade alongside Osama bin Laden in Afghanistan. He now helps keep this country safe by traveling all over the world and thwarting terrorist plots. So let's not forget that we've let in a number of foreign fighters who are British citizens, who have come back and who have been put into de-radicalisation programmes. Those people have not attracted great publicity. It is, I'm afraid, the stupidity of this person, Shamima Begum, who has allowed herself to be interviewed, that gives us really a snapshot of a woman at the sort of peak of her radicalisation. We don't know what the next few months or years in a de-radicalisation programme will produce.
Dr. Alan, final thought from you?
Well, yeah, look, David's right to point out some noble examples of people who have been de-radicalised, but of course there are people who haven't been de-radicalised. The programmes have failed in some instances. And given what he himself has just said about the height of stupidity, as he has put it, in terms of some of the commentary and you know, the height of radicalisation here, I think this is a very difficult case. And that is why, clearly, having weighed it up, the Home Secretary has decided that on balance it is better to exclude her from coming back, in a legal way, of course, because if it was illegal, he himself has stated it wouldn't be something he could or would do, but to exclude her from coming back here in order to protect this country from what she might do should she return.
OK, gentlemen, good to talk to both of you. Thank you very much. Thank